we will specifically focus on counter and deque container types in Python collections. So let us see what outcome has been planned for this video. The outcome associated with this video is to enable the students after watching this video that they'll be able to use counter and deque container types in Python. So let us move to hands-on and what we'll be using hands-on. In the hands-on, we'll try to use counter and deque container types in Python. So I'm going to switch to Google Colab workspace, which is nothing but it's like a Jupyter notebook style service provided by Google, wherein we can try Python code snippets. So let us move to Google Colab workspace. So this is a Google Colab workspace I have here, and let us see one by one how to use counter and how to use deque here. First, see a demonstration of counter, and then we'll also see a demonstration of a deque object. So if you want to use any of these two classes here, counter and deque, make sure you import collections. So I'm going to use from collections, I'll import counter. So this counter is the one which we'll be using to maintain. So let's call it as cvar as a counter variable, and I'm just initializing a new counter container type. Now if I print what's the cvar, so that's, let us see what exactly it prints. So when I execute it, it will just a print counter. Now what I'll do is I'll add few variables to it. For example, it's a, let us call it as cvar1, and now if I print cvar1, I'm trying to just show you the different ways of initializing counter. So cvar1 is in a counter instance with an empty status. So I'll have one more counter status, counter variable. I'll call it a cvar2, but this time I will initialize it with a string abc, and I'll print the cvar2, and at the same time I'll take one more counter variable and I'll call it as counter, and here I'll provide a list of characters, and let me say it's D, it's E, and it's F, and then we'll also print cvar3. And okay, this was the empty counter, and this is empty with a sequence, and it almost both are same. It's a list specifically defined in form of list syntactic structure. So we'll also have cvar4, wherein you can provide direct values. So let's say I have a is equal to 2, b is equal to 3, and g is equal to 9, and I'll print the cvar4. So now when I execute this, you can see the output. So the output of cvar1, cvar2, 3 and 4, this is blank, the output of this line. cvar1 is blank. cvar2, what counter is showing us? So it's actually a sequence. So what it is telling you, that it has tried to maintain a count of iterable, and elements of that iterable are hashable. So it is able to maintain that A occurred once, B occurred once, and C occurred once. At the same time, when you check the output of cvar3, so you can see based on same explanation, D occurs 1, E occurs once, and F occurs 1. And for counter 4, we have specifically defined that A occurs twice, and B occurs thrice, and G occurs 9. Okay. So this is how we are able to initialize a counter object. Now, once we initialize the counter, we can even update the counter as well. For example, here I have A1, B2, and C1. What if I add one more string called as AABB and CC? So I want to add that string and I want to update the counter of that. So what we will do is let us move to another segment here. So we already have this in cvar 2. Now what I'm calling cvar 2 dot, we are updating that. Earlier it has a few count. Now I can directly provide some iterable. And here what I'm saying, AA, BB, CC. So now if I print the output of this cvar 2, you should able to see that the count should get updated, because earlier it's only once, B, C, all occur once, but now I'm updating that. So now if I enter this, you can see that the count has been actually updated here. So update is a method in a counter where it lets me update the count of the whatever the sequences that the counter instance is maintaining. So these are the various installation of a counter, and this is one of the most efficient way to keep track of count of elements. I wanted to show you some functions of collections. You can see that this is standard Python docs. So if you look here, you'll find that these are the some of the other methods which we have seen a demonstration of the most common. Other I leave it to you to practice on your own. So this is very easily accessible. So this is the counter. Now what we are looking into this, we are looking at the dequeue, and what you can see that it's a very fast operation. And most important thing is, this is what the dequeue structure is more famous for. A memory efficient appends and pops for either side of dequeue with approximately almost O of one level of performance. This is what is very much enticing to the developers to use all this. So generally it has the methods append adds it, append left adds to the left, and normal append adds to the right side of the dequeue. So we have it, and one of the very important and a little bit a tricky one is rotate. Dequeue comes with the built-in method to shift elements of dequeue either left or right. So we'll see a demonstration of this. So let us take a small example of a dequeue, so you will be able to understand that. So going back, so from we will have to import it. So from collections, import deque, and then let's say sample deque is equal to dequeue, and I'll provide a list. So you have to provide one, dequeue have to be constructed from a blank list. So even that's also fine. It just creates a sample deque element here. So if you print sample element, sample deque, you should see that it should be just a sample one. And if you print length of this, it will print the current length of the deque structure. Okay, I think we missed a bracket here. Okay. It's zero. So now I can add some elements to this. For that, the call is append. So let us first stick to simple integers. So I'll add element 2 and then I'll print it. So you should be able to check the output. What happens if I do this? Okay, sorry, I misspelled it. It's append, not append. What's wrong? Append requires a collection or dequeue object. Okay, sorry, it has to be this, the element of this. So you can see that it's now containing 2. So now if I do this, let's say I'm adding 4, and if I print it again, what would be the output? What would the output? Would it be 4-2 or 2-4? Let us check it. 2-4, because by default it keeps on adding it to its right. If you want to specifically add an element to the left of that, you have to call append left. You can see that it's 4-2 now. Okay, that's what we were talking about, append and append. So let's add a few elements to this. 4. And now, given the dequeue, which has 6, 5, 4, let us see a demonstration of rotate. So based on the definition with Python doc tells, if I provide n steps, it moves the element to the right. And if n is negative, it moves the elements to the left. So let us call that. We call sample deck dot rotate. And if I say 1, can you guess the output? So I asked you to shift it to the right. Default, this is right. So 2 goes here. So if it's rotate with shift. So the element moves. It's not like that. It moves, goes away, and some random element is it. It rotates. So you can see that dequeue being which gives me O of 1 to pop and left. So if you clearly look into this example, you should get, like, whenever you want to implement a specific rotate operations, especially if you want to rotate an entire list, it would be a very wise decision for a developer to choose dequeue, because a rotate of elements, if it is a dequeue structure, is a little bit more faster than the standard list implementations. Why? It is because of the O of 1 push and pop operations. So you can think of rotate as one pop from left and push to the right. So what do you think? Is dequeue.rotate faster than a list implementation? You can pause the video, or you can just watch the video back and try to find out the answer for this. So the answer for this question, that is yes, dequeue.rotate is a faster implementation than the list implementation of rotation operations. So this is a bibliography. A curious reader can always explore these links to find more about the collections, the time complexity, and what are the arguments which were made in this video. So that's it for this video. Thank you.